Stevie Wiebe here on the boulevard. And one thing that I've always noticed is this saying, you can't see it, but on top of that building it says, Freemasonry builds its temples among the nations and in the hearts of men. That's a Masonic temple. And ironically, the Jimmy Kimmel live building, I mean the Jimmy Kimmel show is taped right there. And supposedly underneath where all these people are walking, there's like secret rooms and tunnels down below. So all these tourists have no idea what's really going on here. I do. Stevie Wiebe's not fooled. Freemasons are alive and well in Hollywood.
We will destroy your four pillars. We will brand your perfidy and sacrifice them on the altars of science. Then bring your church down upon you. Vatican City will be consumed by light, a shining star at the end of the path of illumination.
It's the ancient Illuminati threat, destruction of Vatican City through light. Four pillars, there's your kidnapped cardinals. You didn't tell me they were the preferiti, the favorites to be named the next pope.
Play it again.
We will destroy your four pillars. We will brand your perfidy.
Wait, stop it. Stop.
And sacrifice.
Brand them. That's another Illuminati legend. This one says that there are a set of five brands, each one an ambigram. The first four are the fundamental elements of science: earth, air, fire, and water. The fifth,
it's a mystery. Maybe it's this.
You said they'd be killed publicly.
Yes.
Revenge for La Purga.
La Purga?
Geez, you guys don't even read your own history, do you? 1668. The church kidnapped four Illuminati scientists and branded each one of them on the chest with a symbol of the cross. Purged them of their sins, and they executed them. Threw their bodies out into the street as a warning to others to stop questioning church rulings on scientific matters. They radicalized them. The Purga created a darker, more violent Illuminati, one bent on retribution. And look how they intend to finally get it, using antimatter, technology to destroy the church. Science obliterates religion. Is there any more?
And sacrifice them on the altars of science. Then bring your church down upon you. Vatican City will be consumed by light, a shining star at the end of the path of illumination. 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 The path of illumination.
The path. Of illumination, the path of illumination.
The Illuminati's that shadowy cabal that controls the entire world and ensures free will's an illusion. They've got a big Facebook page. Celebrities like Jay-Z are accused of being members. And there are weird YouTubers like this guy.
They had weirdos standing up everywhere, and then Beyonce, show a document cam shot of this if you can. She does the Illuminati symbol. What, tell folks what you saw.
But what about the real history of the Illuminati and how it became what it is today? This is Bavaria, and in 1776, Adam Weishaupt, a law professor, founded the Illuminati. It's real. He wanted to spread Enlightenment ideals around the world. The goal was to infiltrate the monarchy and make them more enlightened by entering their ranks. Even though they were so high-minded, they had weird rituals. See these owls? The Illuminati really loved them. And they had invented hierarchies like novice, Minerval, and illuminated. Even though they were weird, they did have some success around the world. Anywhere from 650 to 2,800 members infiltrated Freemason chapters, may have had influential members like the writer Goethe, and even might have influenced the Jacobins, the political club that spurred the French Revolution to its most radical heights. But they were destroyed in 1785. This is Karl Theodor. He was the Duke of Bavaria, and that year he banned secret societies that included the Illuminati. Most historians think that it worked, and the Illuminati disappeared. But if that's true, then why do we still think Drake's Illuminati today, just because he wears owl sweaters? Since the beginning, conspiracy theories have been part of the Illuminati. This guy, Xavier von Zwack, actually did have plans to take over the world that were found after the Illuminati was banned. American historians and preachers thought the Illuminati planted some seeds for the French Revolution, and George Washington even wrote a letter that claimed the Illuminati had once been a threat. But the Illuminati lost the limelight thanks to the Freemasons. This is George Washington as a Freemason, and a lot of founding fathers really were Freemasons. That inspired the anti-Masonic party. It was a legitimate movement with big names like John Quincy Adams, and the Illuminati paranoia faded around the world. So, how did the myth stay alive? There were always random books like this one from 1918 or book reviews that mentioned the Illuminati, but most people think the Illuminatus book trilogy of the 1970s deserves credit for bringing the Illuminati back. It might also be why weird secret symbols like these, pyramids and triangles, are associated with the Illuminati. It was a funny series and gave new life to the conspiracy for an ironic, connected age. They were an evil organization bent on ruling the world, sure, but they were also kind of funny. The Illuminati was vague enough to be refit to any purpose, from the New World Order to religious paranoia to pop culture curio like angels and demons. It became a joke. But you might believe that's what the Illuminati wants you to think if you notice the 14 evil yellow triangles of power hidden inside this video. The Illuminati really only endures because it's disappeared and can look like anything. There's nothing to worry about.
Nothing at all.
Yo, 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 yo. You little hoe. We are back for Mo. Go Deep, episode 233. I think it's episode 233. I'm pretty sure it's episode 233. Yes, it is episode 233. I hope you like that intro. Hope you like the title. I hope you liked your mom. Because all I was doing was just stalling to make sure I got it the right episode, 233. today is going to be a good show. Today we are talking about the biggest discussion ever. You know, science or God. Illuminati versus the Masons. Ooh, go deep. But first, before we go deep, we must listen to some music. Because we're going to talk about some deep shit today. Because this deep shit is pretty much everything. This is some deep fucking shit. So since I already know I just ruined the algorithm for YouTube, because they say if you curse within the first few minutes, then you're gonna get shelved. But guess what? I don't care. All right. I quit. Let's get into some music. We'll be right back. Thank you for coming. Subscribe, like, and share. Tell your girlfriend about me. I will make her happy, and she will go home to you a better wife. Yeah, bitch!
I won't deny you. I'm a straight ride. You don't wanna fuck with me. Got the police busting at me. I can't do nothing to you. Let's go.
go to the telly, ho. Money, money in the bin, cause bitch, I'm belly broke. I'm buying bomb ass weed, feeling crucial. From player to player, the gang's fight, the feeling's mutual. I'm hustling and praying, so begging motherfuckers to pay us. I got no time for these bitches, gonna be so hard to play. Some on a meal, ticket mission, want to meet. So I'm wishing competition got me blitz on that bullshit, play stress.
Yo, all right, we back. Hope you like that music, that song. I don't know if you like that song or not, because I don't know what I put in there. I'm pretty sure you like that song, because I think I got a good taste of music. Chopped and Screwed, maybe. You know, everybody's not into that type of shit, but whatever. Your mama is. So, we're back. Go Deep, episode 233. We're back for some fucking deep shit today, boys. So check this out. Pretty much like everything is about these two shit, you know? And like I used to say, you know, I used to like interviewing people. I used to always talk about this, but sometimes when I interview people, we don't really cover shit. Some people just talk. when I was more in the Snyder Cut movement, and I just would like interview anybody. Sometime I got strayed away from what the fuck we were supposed to be talking about. And I noticed that like a year into it, I was like, damn. But I mean, shouts out to everybody that gave the interviews, and I appreciate them shit. But some interviews I got, it matched. Some interviews I got, it actually fit the bill. Some interviews I got, it you know, and I kind of try to talk to like my homeboy, Carlos Diaz, and I got another interview with Carlos coming up, because Carlos is on a roll right now, and I got to talk to my Mexican dog in Texas. Sometimes when I talk to Cole J, I could tell Cole J understood it. You could tell Cole J understood maybe the science of religion, and it sounds crazy to say that, but I don't know. You could tell he understood, and pretty much all of our conversations, we went deep because both of those guys could understand it, you know? And a lot of times I like to talk to people who could understand that shit and go that deep, because I think that's the reason we all came here. I think we all had a spiritual experience in life, and somewhere it kind of drew us all together, because we have all like a little mutual respect for, well, we don't got a mutual respect for some bitches. Some niggas is whack. But for the most of us, we got a mutual respect for each other, because we probably can feel where each other has been coming from. We probably sympathize with each other. Which I guess science will call that like a connection. But it's a connection that can't be explained by science just yet. And it's pretty much the biggest fucking mystery of the fucking world. It's pretty much what every Hollywood movie, not every Hollywood movie, not like rom-coms and shit like that. It's pretty much what these big sci-fi blockbusters are all talking about, the same thing. Like, let's say Avatar, for example. Avatar, you know, they use science. They created this technology, these machines, to shoot their consciousness into a different body, who tried to infiltrate a tribe of people who had a connection spiritually together that the scientists and the military didn't understand. Couldn't comprehend. Even the trees had a fucking connection to each other. You know, everything had a connection to each other, like life. But then you see this same story in Star Wars, you know? Fucking a farmer's kid, you know, went up against the Empire because the Empire was so big and strong, but didn't understand the Force. The Force. You know what I'm saying? This is like what Hollywood is talking about. Fucking The Matrix. All of it is talking about that. And I saw this new shit. I haven't watched WandaVision. I probably won't watch WandaVision, but one of the podcasts that I like to listen to just did a piece on WandaVision and was saying how WandaVision is just The Matrix. I'll put it in there, but I'll put it in this video. Hopefully I don't get a content strike. Probably will get a content strike. Hopefully it still allow me to play it, though, because I can deal with the content strike if y'all get the message, which means y'all boys subscribe to my shit, you know? All right, so let's get back on it. WandaVision, I haven't watched it, but supposedly Scarlet Witch, a witch, is shooting out a matrix and blinded a whole city to believe that life is one way when life is a certain different way. While that witch can fall in love with an AI, you know, vision, AI technology, you know, blah, blah, blah. That's the world of today. That's the matrix. That's supposedly the fucking Catholic Church. That's it, guys. That's the answer. So then you got the Catholic Church, this big empire, right? Who use kind of their knowledge of the Force to create an empire. And which I mean knowledge of the Force, I mean knowledge of like spirituality. It's a church, you know? They use that knowledge of spirituality, which is kind of like the Force, because, you know, you can call it what you want. You can be Jewish, Muslim, Christian, Hindu, Buddhist, blah, blah, blah. Your spirituality that you're calling basically a force of nature, you're giving a name to a force of nature, right? Now, whoever can hone that force of nature and trick the mindsets of the masses, just like on Book of Eli, you know, the white dude wanted the Bible so he could control the whole fucking city. The Bible is the spirituality force. But then the Wanderer, Denzel Washington, didn't want to give him the Force because he wouldn't use it right. Doesn't that sound like Star Wars? Luke Skywalker used the Force, right? It's doesn't it sound like Neo? It's the biggest shit. This is what everybody's talking about. We just don't know it because they put it in different ways of fucking fiction or, you know, like some comic shit that we don't know really what's going on. But not only is it in Hollywood, but this is like a Hollywood podcast, so we'll talk about it in that sense, but it's the whole world. It's how we... So the last world order was God. It was control. The control system was religion. The Catholic Church pretty much ran that for 2,000 years. So the new world order is religion, is science. And they are trying to answer all the questions of God's ability, God's force. How did God do this? How did God create this? How did God do this? You know, we don't pray to God anymore. We ask Alexa and we ask Google for the answers to all of our woes. It's the new world order. The last world order is falling. And they've been doing it. They've been falling. They've been bringing it down in your lifetime. You know, if they're my black people listening to me, we all knew, you know, on the streets, there's all this quote unquote knowledge. And the knowledge is like supposed to be black people. We supposed to be speaking some supreme mathematics. Mathematics is just fucking science, math and science. And all this new knowledge is supposed to tell you how Jesus is fake and all of this shit. You're tearing down the old world order. But the fact that America itself is a Judeo-Christian, supposedly built on Christian values and Jew values or whatever. When you tear that down, you are also tearing down the country you live in. Which is causing some havoc and causing some shit. But check this out. Here's what's even deeper. You don't know why you're doing that. You're being brainwashed to do that by somebody who wants to tear down that old world order of, you know, religion being the dominant structure of society, led by the Vatican. This new world order is a large conglomerate of scientists. Let's say, like we all knew growing up, they call them evil genius or evil scientists or whatever. Who knows if they're evil, whatever. But they're here to disprove God. They're here to bring the light of illumination to you that say you are the gods also. Why? Because supposedly a single spark created all of us. Now, if they can create that spark, created everything, like Flash or like that Zack Snyder shirt, you know, that spark started and just went zoom, 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 zoom all the way around. And then it created everything. It created existence. Supposedly, science says creation was made with radiation, which is sunlight radiating, which is the eye of Horus, sunlight radiating, and sound. Sound and radiation together started creation in space, I guess. I don't know. That's what these high scientists think, and that's what they're looking for. And they're going to try to disprove God. But while they try to disprove God, a lot of people are going to hate them because a lot of people still stuck in that old world system. So it's going to be like the corporations are going to try to disprove God because the corporations feel they are gods. And now the corporations have enough money to fund and find that spark of creation. And that's what they're doing with CERN. But as they do that, they have to get the zombies, the people, to disprove God also. So all of this knowledge, quote unquote knowledge, and all of this bullshit you're learning, and all of this shit is just to get you to tear down the previous world order. All of this shit you see, including in movies, it's all the same shit. I'm still watching Army of the Dead, and I'm getting some shit, but I think Army of the Dead is about CERN. I think Army of the Dead is about the Vatican because, I mean, not for nothing. All right, listen to this. Jesus, he was dealing with the dominant structure of society, the Catholic Church, the Romans. They killed him with the Jews who, I guess, turned on him or whatever. But listen, he had his 12 disciples. He had his people. He had his little crew, basically, who was going and basically changing the minds of the people in that society of the, you know, run by the Roman Catholic Church. Okay. So now you got Neo and Morpheus, the little crew, going to fucking defeat the dominant structure that's cloning everybody on some dumb shit and bringing a matrix above their eyes or whatever. Same story. Lord of the Rings. Frodo and his little crew going against the dominant control structure. Same story as Star Wars. Their little crew. rebels against the major control structure. But your real life, the little crew, the Masons, rebelling against the church, because maybe the Templars rebelled against the Vatican, or maybe the Vatican crushed the Templars or whatever. Is this shit still going on in real life? You bet your life it is. It's the same shit. They're showing you the same little crew of you and your homies that can get up and say, man, fuck this shit. This matrix of fucking bullshit is over the whole city and got everybody into zombies, and we're going to have to figure this out on ourselves and bring that system down. Just like in Army of the Dead. I mean, in Army of the Dead, they went and they all lost their life because they wanted money. But money is freedom. Money is, if you look at it, you got to change your brain. Money is kind of God also. That's why the all-seeing eye is on money. Because when you get a lot of it, you don't have to go to work for no crackhead or whatever. You don't have to go to work for no dumbass boss that's going to just bullshit you all day. You can get up when you want. You can do what you want. You don't have to want for anything. Your family don't have to want for anything because you have the freedom of wealth, right? That freedom is kind of like God. Right? So they went in the desert. They went in that, you know, they went into Vegas. And what does she say in Vegas? This is not their, they're not fucking being in prison. This is their fucking palace. This is their kingdom. This is what she said about the zombies. The Vatican Kingdom. Okay. The Vatican keeps this little mindset of, you know, Jesus or whatever, you know, religion. And supposedly that religion has got everyone in a zombie-like state. And they just don't do the correct work because they think, you know, Jesus will take care of it. And that, you know, whatever. That's just what they think. All right. So they went in there to find God. They went into that safe to find God. That money is their God. They wanted relief. They wanted freedom of the life that they're currently in. They all died looking for that because the scare of finding God, the God particle, is a big kaboom. What did you see on Army of the Dead? It was a big nuclear bomb. I mean, big boom. Looking for God, that is the scare of what's going to happen. That's a real scare in real life. You know, that's the same story as Justice League. You know, maybe that's the answer to the time loop, because time travel in Justice League is not, you know, jumping in some spaceship and going the speed of light. Time travel in Justice League is a portal, the safecracker. You know, oh, is a portal. That's how the Germans actually, maybe that's what Zack Snyder is talking about. That's what the cracker is. The safe cracker is CERN. Shit's in Geneva, Switzerland. They financed the Nazis. The Nazis are a group of people who were a religion more than they were a fucking country. They were a religion. They're the ones that brought this occult shit that we still live today. You know? I mean, this might be deep. This is just part one. So I'm going to just stop right here. I'm going to put some white people in here. And the white people are going to explain it more than I am, because this is just going to be part one. We can talk about it more on part two. But I know I said some stuff that got your brain rolling already. But this is some real life shit. This is some deep shit. This is what everybody is talking about. Because this is what's going on right now, you bitch. Let's get into some white people. So y'all can be like, okay, I kind of understand, though. He talked like a white dude. Yeah, bitch.
The I realize that the topic of my talk, Will Science Kill God, is a little bit ponderous, so I'm actually shocked anybody's here, so thank you for coming. I write novels with recurring themes of religion, faith, and man's quest for the divine. And I said earlier today that I accepted this invitation to speak at Web Summit because I believe that a lot of you, those who are creating technologies of the future, will do as much to shape the future of human spirituality as will all of the world's religious leaders combined. For centuries, science and religion have both vied to be that infallible source from which we draw our truth. And depending on our upbringings, our own source of miracles and truth may be the pages of Holy Scripture, or it may be the pages of scientific journals. As a child, I had some trouble finding my way. My mother was a deeply devout Christian church organist, and my father was a professor of mathematics and probability. So I was lost from day one. To give you the idea of the outspoken piousness of my mother, I actually brought something of hers to show you. For years as I grew up, she drove me to school and to soccer practice in a bright red Volvo turbo station wagon with a very unique license plate. And I actually brought it. Here is my mother's license plate. Kyrie. I'm sure, as I can tell that you're laughing, one of you laughed. This is the Latin transliteration of the vocative case for the Greek word of Lord. It is the most common word in the Byzantine Rite Christian liturgy, which is what makes it so hilarious. My mom was not at all shy about her religious beliefs, and my father was equally enthusiastic about his passion for mathematics, so much so that he penned 13 internationally best-selling textbooks, and I'm betting a large number of you actually used my dad's textbooks in school. And if you're wondering what it did for my popularity at school to have a father who essentially wrote everyone's math homework, it was not good. I had very few dates. Living in a house with a God-fearing mother and a math-crazed father was a little bit schizophrenic. At dinner time, my mother would say grace and thank the Lord for all the blessings that had been bestowed upon us. And then my father would promptly take the baby carrots on our plate and use them to teach us about conic sections. I learned at a young age that depending on how I cut my carrot, I could create a cross-section that was a circle, an ellipse, a parabola, or if I were really skilled with my knife, the holy grail of all dinnertime carrot cuts, the hyperbola. I did that once, too. When we went out for pizza, my dad would gather us around the pizza pie, and that is pie, P-I. Course. He would teach us about degrees of arc, areas, and circles, and I cannot tell you how embarrassing it was to stand in line at Romeo's Pizza with my father and his brand new Texas Instruments calculator, and you're probably too young to remember what these things looked like. They were giant. They cost $800. They were computers that you sort of held in front of you, and he would use this calculator to figure out whether it was more cost-effective to buy a large, two smalls, maybe a small and a medium, you know. So this from the guy who wrote Advanced Mathematics. By the way, my father's license plate when I was growing up, I brought that one too. Here it is. Okay, I guess we found the right crowd. My dad's a huge fan of the metric system, and America's total failure to adopt it still bothers him on a deeply spiritual level. He's getting up there in years, and I said, "Hey, Dad, I'm going over to Ireland." He said, "Please tell me they've fully switched over to the metric system." So when I go home, I'm going to tell him that all the Irish pubs now serve pints of Guinness in 473 milliliter glasses. So he will be overjoyed. Anyhow, growing up, despite my parents' Kyrie metric conflict and my rather paradoxical upbringing, I was quite happy in these two worlds of science and religion. But once I matured to the all-knowing age of 13, I started to realize that these two different worldviews posed all kinds of contradictions. The Bible said God created the universe in 7 days, but in school I just learned about the Big Bang. The Bible said God made Adam and Eve and all the animals, but I had gone to the Boston Museum of Science and seen fossils and heard about how everything evolved. And so I asked a priest, how should I reconcile these inconsistencies? Essentially, I asked him, which story is true? And this particular priest replied, "Nice boys don't ask that question." At that very moment, I became fascinated with the interplay between science and religion. Thousands of years ago, when science was in its primordial stages, the ancients developed an extensive pantheon of gods and goddesses to explain just about everything they didn't understand about their natural world. Thunder, lightning, earthquakes, infertility, the movement of the tides, plagues, even love. Thunder, the ancients decided, was caused by Thor angrily throwing lightning bolts. The ebb and flow of the oceans was attributed to the shifting moods of Poseidon, and pandemic disease was a plague sent by a vengeful god. This kind of spirituality is known as the God of the Gaps. That is, when there were gaps in the ancients' understanding of the world, they filled those gaps with God. Over time, however, the progress of science began removing those gaps, and the pantheon of gods started to shrink. For example, we now understand the science of thunder and lightning, and Thor has been banished as a false god and a foolish myth of an ignorant time. We no longer turn to God for answers as to why the tides flow or why plague spread. Science has answered those questions. We now turn to God for the answers to a handful of questions that science has never been able to answer. Where do we come from? Why are we here? What happens when we die? And in asking these questions, we realize that we, just like the ancients, still worship the God of the Gaps. We still call upon God to fill the gaps in our understanding of the human experience. Nonetheless, those gaps have shrunk dramatically over time. Nowadays, with the exception of the big existential questions, which are still very much the realm of God, science rather than religion is the lens through which we increasingly see our world. When there's an earthquake, for example, most of us, including the deeply devout, will frame that event as a geologic release of tectonic pressure, not a punishment sent by a wrathful God. Christianity's long-held belief that God placed mankind at the center of the universe was disproven by the scientific discoveries of Copernicus and Galileo, who proved that God not only failed to place mankind at the center of the universe, he didn't even place us at the center of our own solar system. A similar thing happened to the biblical account of Adam and Eve, who, if you choose to read the scripture literally, God created as fully formed human beings, who then procreated and spawned the entire human race, including all of the different ethnicities, with none of the problems of inbreeding. To my mind, the story of Adam and Eve simply does not hold up in the face of the fossil record, Charles Darwin, and evolutionary science. I have learned too much through science to believe that particular myth, even if I desperately want to. If we look at this trend of science eating away at the claims of religion, we have to wonder if the same process of demystification and de-religionization will continue into the future, extending itself perhaps even to these final few existential questions. I can't help but wonder what happens someday if a biologist employs advances in computing, genetics, and biochemistry to create a concoction in a petri dish from which suddenly springs life. In that moment, abruptly, that Sistine Chapel image of God reaching down to infuse mankind with life starts to look a bit like an ancient Roman drawing of Minerva springing from the head of Jupiter, a notion that we now find antiquated and obsolete. And what about the question, why are we here? For centuries, religions have taught us that humans are special in God's eyes, that we are God's supreme creation, and that we hold the highest place in God's heart above all the other creatures. In light of that, I can't help but wonder about the spiritual repercussions of the following scenario. Imagine sometime in the future, a genetic scientist uses quantum computers to model the entire human evolutionary process, maybe even gene by gene. And she uses that model to extrapolate and predict the future changes to our DNA over the next 1,000 years, only to discover that human beings evolve into something quite different, or that we're destined for extinction. What does that knowledge do to our relationship with our Creator? What does it do to our spiritual sense of our place in the cosmos to realize that our species, like the lungfish or Homo erectus, is really just a passing phase on the evolutionary continuum, a fleeting grace note on the scale of time. And what about the biggest of all existential questions, that question that inspires even the most skeptical of us to open the door to God, even a crack? The question, what happens when we die? In that final moment, do all of our hopes and dreams and memories simply disintegrate and evaporate into the ether? It seems logical. After all, our memories are simply a series of electrical charges stored in a brain whose power cable is just cut. And yet religion, all religions, promise there is indeed something beyond the moment of death. Some of you may recall the 1990 movie Flatliners, about a group of medical students experimenting with near-death experiences, letting themselves die for a full minute before having their colleagues bring them back from the dead to discuss what they had experienced in the afterlife. It's a great premise, one that will probably not remain fiction forever. At some point in the future, medical science may well develop a way to enable humans to die temporarily and to stay dead long enough that when we return, we have some serious quantifiable knowledge about the afterlife, or, heaven forbid, its total absence. But if there is an afterlife, will Christians and Muslims and Hindus and atheists all have different death experiences? And if not, if they all have identical experiences, what does that say about the unique claims of each religion regarding the afterlife? I'm also curious about artificial intelligence and synthetic consciousness. If we create an AI machine that eventually becomes conscious, what happens if we leave that machine all alone in the dark, telling it nothing about who created it or why? Letting this artificial consciousness float in the digital void, much like we earthbound humans float in the void of space. Will this machine start to ask itself how it came to be? Will it develop a profound curiosity about its maker? Will it go so far as to invent histories and mythologies to explain how it might have been created? Simply stated, if we build a conscious machine and we don't tell it how and why it was created, will it want to know? And if it does want to know, can we conclude that one of the byproducts of consciousness is a need to define our creator? And that even an artificial mind so craves the comfort of knowing its maker that a machine would rather create a fiction than to admit it just doesn't know. I write a character, Robert Langdon, who is quite comfortable living on that dividing line between science and religion. If Robert Langdon were here, he would tell us science and religion are simply two different languages attempting to tell the same story. A big part of me believes that too, even though most of the evidence is to the contrary. Historically, science and religion have functioned less as partners than as mortal enemies. I mentioned earlier how scientific progress has undermined religious authority, but make no mistake about it, religious authority has been no friend to science. In the 8th century, the greatest learning center on earth was Baghdad. For 500 years, the outpouring of scientific innovation from Baghdad was like nothing the world had ever seen. And we still use their scientific inventions today, still calling them by their Arabic names: algebra, algorithms, alchemy, chemistry, ciphers, and my father's favorite, the number zero. Then in the 11th century, a religious leader named Hamid al-Ghazali wrote a series of persuasive texts declaring mathematics the philosophy of the devil, and urging that scientific study to be replaced by the theological study. Almost overnight, scientific investigation was replaced by religious revelation, and the entire scientific movement collapsed there. Christian clerics mounted similar religious assaults on science, directed at Bruno, Galileo, and Copernicus, either burning, imprisoning, or discrediting some of science's most brilliant minds and ideas. And this is still happening today. Recently in Madrid, the World Federation of Catholic Medical Associations declared war on genetic medicine, proclaiming that science lacks soul and therefore should be restrained by the church. In my own country, there are science teachers attempting to teach evolution who are besieged and physically threatened by angry parents demanding equal billing for creationism and for Adam and Eve. About a decade ago, the United States set out to build the largest particle collider in the world, the superconducting supercollider, which had the potential to unveil the very moment of creation, and yet ironically was slated to be built in Texas in the heart of America's Bible Belt. The project was killed, due in large part to cost overruns, but also due in part to vocal leaders like Representative Sherwood Bollert, who made his now famous declaration on the floor of the Senate. Bollert said, "I doubt anyone believes that the most pressing issues facing this nation include an insufficient understanding of the creation of the universe." I beg to differ with that one. So where is it all leading? Will science and religion ever learn to get along? And if not, if they keep doing battle, will there ever be a winner? If you look at the two players, science and religion are as different from each other as they could possibly be. Religions over the centuries have remained unchanged in their fundamental beliefs and tenets. In many ways, that is their strength and attractiveness, that religions have stayed steadfast, self-assured, consistent, and timeless. Science and technology, on the other hand, have changed dramatically over time. Now scientific progress is happening so rapidly that our minds can barely keep up. It took early humans over a million years to go from discovering fire to inventing a wheel. Then it took only 2,000 years to invent the printing press. Then a mere 200 years to build a telescope. In the 200 years that followed that, we jumped from the telescope to a steam locomotive. And then in another 200 years, from the steam locomotive to the space shuttle. And then it took only 2 decades for us to start modifying our own DNA. We now measure scientific progress in months, experiencing quantum leaps at a mind-boggling pace. It will not take long before the fastest supercomputer of today looks like an abacus in the face of emerging technologies, or before today's most advanced surgical methods start to look barbaric to us, or before even using a physical power cable starts to seem as quaint as the days of using a candle. The early Greeks had to look back centuries to study ancient culture. We need look back only a single generation to find those who lived without the majority of technologies that we now take for granted. The timeline of human development is compressing. The space that separates ancient and modern is shrinking to nothing at all. The technologies of the future will enable our species to achieve things we cannot yet even imagine. They will give us new powers of creativity and exploration. They will radically enhance the way we interact with humans. Interact as humans. With a little luck, particle physicists might even make contact with a parallel universe. I know that CERN here in Europe was talking about that recently. Biological engineers might unlock the untapped potential of the human mind. And if that happens, who knows what the future of spirituality will look like. The real question facing us now, I think, is whether or not our technologies and philosophies will keep pace with each other. As our technologies race forward, will our philosophies keep pace? Will our moralities evolve fast enough to address the questions that we can't even yet imagine? Will our ethics help us responsibly to wield the dazzling tools that we're now creating? Religion and faith, in all of its traditions and forms around the world, will, of course, play an influential role in this process. It always has. And so as I think about the future, I find myself wondering what the role of our existing gods will be in the philosophies of tomorrow. Now, this will be a personal decision for each of us. And as we make those decisions, I only hope that we can remember this. There is nothing in our DNA that predetermines our beliefs. We are not born into this world believing that a particular God is the true God. We are born into a culture. We worship the gods of our parents. If all of us in this room had been born in the mountains of Tibet, most of us would be Buddhists, and we would hold on to that Buddhist philosophy with the same passion that we now hold on to our current faiths. We worship the gods of our parents. It is truly that simple. The world is getting smaller every day, and now more than ever, there is enormous danger in believing that we are infallible, that our version of the truth is absolute, and that everyone who does not think like we do is wrong and therefore an enemy. For our own survival, it is critical that we live with open minds, that we educate ourselves, that we ask difficult questions, and above all, that we engage in dialogue, especially with those whose ideas are not our own. And so in closing, in the name of dialogue and sharing ideas, I want to acknowledge that what has brought us here this afternoon in this room is the uniquely human instinct to connect in person, to learn from one another, and to share ideas, and to engage in dialogue. I want to thank the Web Summit for making this dialogue possible, and I want to thank all of you for coming today. Thank you.
Black and red, blood-injected, upside-down, pentagram-sporting Satan shoes by Lil Nas X, as well as his serpent alien Satan lap-dancing Montero video, could only be released a week before Easter. This is business as usual. It has almost become a part of Christian celebrations to expect a few of these smears in the mainstream media before important Christian holidays. There's something boring and tedious about the whole affair, a nicely organized propaganda supply chain with just-in-time delivery. Nonetheless, beyond my first reaction of dismissal, I found that maybe there's something people might want to understand in these satanic tropes and these satanic moves. None of it is arbitrary, but like any system of meaning, it rather has a strange coherence. And this coherence can give us a few clues as to why this imagery would be used to attract the type of attention someone like Lil Nas X desperately needs in order to stay relevant in a post-Christian, blasé, porn-infused, hungover culture. And I guess I should tip my fedora to Lil Nas X as he does a bang-up job at weaving all this imagery succinctly together. But the Lil Nas X situation probably wouldn't have been enough for me to put any energy into this. In fact, there's a second angle entering this video. So many people have been telling me to watch WandaVision, which at first I didn't want to do, but I end up doing it. And the ending of this series lays out imagery that is very similar to Lil Nas X. And it ends up being like a feminine witchcraft, which contrasts to the more masculine satanic imagery in the Lil Nas X video, while nonetheless playing in similar tones as Montero's Hellish Carnival.
This is Jonathan Peugeot. Welcome to the symbolic world.
So before I get on with this, yes, I remember the so-called satanic panic in the 1980s. I remember these pastors telling us about backtracking and how rock songs had secret satanic messages when played backwards. But even as a young teenager, I often wondered why they needed to look for secret messages when the overt messages were pretty clear, you know, you didn't need the backward ones. People are really bad at hiding what they're doing. If you pay attention, they'll tell you what they're up to, especially if you know what to watch for. So the Montero video is a rather disturbing sight to behold. In a world inhabited only by versions of himself, Lil Nas X sings about his intimate encounter, let's call him, and his obsession with a man who has the same name as him, Montero. And Call Me By Your Name is the unofficial title of the song. The video ultimately is about one thing. It's about pride. This self-love is represented as an exploration of the strangeness and idiosyncrasies of oneself. Self-seduction, self-victimizing, self-abasement, self-gratification, and ultimately self-crowning. In speaking to his self-named lover, Montero tells us that, "I'm not fazed, only here to sin. If Eve ain't in your garden, you know that you can." And so pride as self-love appears ultimately as a sterile revolution against the natural patterns of the world, a desire for the world to be solipsistic, to be contained by myself, for the world to be in my image, and a desire to be free from the usual constraints of natural patterns and cycles of being. He tells his self-named lover that he wants to, let's say, I won't quote it exactly, but let's say to put a child in his mouth. And this is, of course, the ultimate image of sterility, of solipsistic dreaming, of this imagination which is taken up in fantastical places but does not produce body, community, or cohesion, but only causes revolution, fragmentation, and ultimately loneliness. Montero tells us that what he wants to do, he wants to do to the ones he envies. And we have entered the pattern of revolution, of attempting to come up, then come in from behind. So we find Montero under the tree of knowledge in the primordial garden, where he's first frightened, but then seduced by a serpent figure. The serpent figure is a hybrid in the tradition of Renaissance depictions of the serpent, which have often been linked to Lilith by historians. The hybrid also takes on the imagery of the alien. So of course, this hybrid alien demon serpent figure is one that has become the narrative monster of conspiracy theorists from David Icke to QAnon. So it could be easy for many to dismiss all of this as a kind of trolling. And this is indeed the game being played, I think. But there's something else going on, because even if it is just trolling, the question remains, why does Montero invoke this very precise imagery in this video? To gain attention? To provoke? To subvert? Well, yes, yes, and yes, but the error that we might make is to believe that it stops there. That such an answer somehow explains what is actually happening. But in search of a more subtle understanding, one needs to ask, first of all, why these narrative elements crystallized the fears and worry of so many people at the time they did. And then especially, we need to ask why someone like Montero is allowed to embody these fears so perfectly at this moment in order to increase his fame. Of course, it's about attention. But the reason why certain things will bring you attention rather than condemnation or just lack of interest at certain moments in a cycle of attention is not arbitrary at all. And understanding this can help us understand where we are going in our social narrative. So whether or not Lil Nas X is an actual literal Satanist, this is something that I don't have access to. But even the patterns of the stories that we live and that we tell ourselves, they're not arbitrary. And observing them can help us understand what is going on. So in the video, after his seduction by the serpent, it follows Montero to a kind of coliseum where he's chained and judged by cross-dressed versions of himself. He's then stoned by these dusty zombie figures that are replicas of him, and then he's finally killed with some disturbing sex toy. So, yeah. He ascends into the sky to meet a shadowy angel, but this pole/lance, shoots up from below. And as Montero grabs it, he begins to slide down in the guise of a pole dancer into the belly of hell. And let's be honest, if there was ever a perfect representation of the, let's call it, ontological reality of pole dancing, pretty sure this is it. The pole coming up from below is, of course, an inversion of the spear of St. Michael, which is portrayed in medieval imagery as pinning down the great serpent that is Satan coming from above. But now this spear/pole is coming to claim Montero from behind with all the undertones that also includes. So even though it's coming from below, it's nonetheless this axis mundi, the axis of the world. It nonetheless is this hierarchy which connects heaven and earth together, though now it's not a hierarchy seen from the side of the traditional, let's say, ladder that you see in icons of the ladder of divine ascent, which is going up in humility and worship and self-transformation, but rather it's this coming up from behind of revolution. And this type of coming up from behind doesn't end up being going up in the end. It just actually ends up being a coming down, being chased from heaven, which is what you see in the story of the red dragon in Revelation that uses its tail to knock down the stars from the sky. And then he ends up falling down onto the earth, into the sea. And so it's not the axis from the point of view of the ladder, but it's something like this hierarchy from the point of view of the chute or of the serpent sliding down, just like in a chutes and ladders game. So we see the movement from the periphery. We see it from the wheel that's wrapped around the axis, which turns and slithers and seduces onlookers by its changeability and by leading them into their passions. So Montero is actually replaying the first part of the video here, this part where he was seduced by the serpent, which was sliding down the tree, but now he is the serpent who will slide down in order to seduce Satan himself. So ending up in a caricature of hell with the thorn-covered door, which is nice touch in terms of symbolism, Montero lap dances Satan into this simulated sexual act to then himself come up behind the evil one to break his neck, to steal his horns and his crown, replacing the devil in what we could call a final revolution, a revolution which is the supremacy of the self. So for a satanic story, I would say it actually scores pretty well. So you can imagine that the media coverage about this little Nas X scandal has been mostly about how Christians are reacting to it, how they are offended, how they're falling into a new satanic panic, how they're too stupid to see the provocative humor and the social message in all of this.
To me, the potential message to the youth in this video is that you can find strength in being exactly who you are, whoever that is.
So let's be honest, this is what the whole circus is about. It's about getting attention. Like I said at the outset, it's not arbitrary that this image was put out there just before Easter. You see, Satanism has systematically been about Christianity from its very beginning. And especially modern pop Satanism, with all the contemporary popular imagery out there, from Anton LaVey's celebrity status and his movie acting to bands like Black Sabbath and other forms of heavy metal Satanism, all these upside down crosses, the black masses, the celebration of sin and of our passions are all about embodying in a narrative, in a mythological setting, the end of Christianity. And by embodying, it's the end of its hold on the mythic narrative or the social narrative. But secretly and unknowingly, it is restating it. But that's for another time that we could talk about that. Once one understands this, many things will appear to us more clearly. Even the ironic aspect of Satanism and cultural provocations like the Satanic Shoes or this Montero video. You see, Satanism is irony itself, you could say. From its ritual version of the black masses to its more philosophical social manifestation, it is the Christian story restated from its upside down, from its narrative margin. Satanism is something like the gargoyle as priest, the rebel as king. And the theatrics, the joke of Satanism, is one of the most important considerations of its meaning and its purpose, and ultimately of its satanic qualities. So if you ask a LaVey-style Satanist about their religion, they'll tell you that they actually don't believe in Satan. This is, of course, difficult for Christians who order their lives on truth and faith to understand. People ask themselves, why would they go to such efforts for something they don't even believe in? And of course, such a reaction comes from decent, normal, you know, healthy people who can't see how there's nothing more satanic than believing both God and Satan actually don't exist, though all the while acting in this self-righteous pride and resentment in order to offend Christians and destroy their hierarchy of meanings by ritually and mythologically embodying everything that Christians oppose. Always remember that the Montero video ends with the putting of the satanic crown on oneself. All of this is what happened recently in the whole Baphomet statue hubbub that surrounded the Satanic Temple in the United States. And embracing the very ambiguous and egalitarian American notion of religious freedom, these satanic pranksters are able to show how Americans are potentially Satanists because they must equally, an emphasis on equally, include the parody and opposite of what most of them believe in. In a traditional world, there's a hierarchy, the monsters, the demons, the gargoyles, and especially the Satan or the opponent are on the outside, or they're underground, they're below us. And it's best to actually not even pronounce their names. But now, in the context of liberty and equality driving social forms, the figure of Satan begins to appear as a dark prophet of the modern world, a noble Promethean who tragically stood against authority and declared himself equal to that which was above him. In the Montero video, Lil Nas X gets it right. Satanic imagery has never ultimately been about worshiping the devil, but rather about embodying the revolutionary pattern through the type of pride exemplified by Satan in his war against heaven, and which ends with self-worship and self-crowning. And obviously it can't really end that way, for Montero's only claim to the crown of horns is violence and revolution, which means that there is always another pole riding, lap dancing, you know, person in line waiting to kill Montero and to take the crown from him. But let's just say that that's another story as well. One of the tropes of the anti-Christian religious scholar of the past decades has been to point to how idiosyncratic the devil of pop Satanism actually is. The brooding red demon, the horns, the trident, the goat-like appearance, all of this, they tell us, is just an early modern development which grew with layers of additions in time from this horned monster that we see present in late medieval images of the Last Judgment, through these frenzied descriptions of witches and devils in the Malleus Maleficorum. This Malleus is the Hammer of Witches, which was the famous text used in early modern witch trials. We move then to Milton's Lucifer and Faust's Mephistopheles. So these pompous religious scholars remind us that this figure has little to do with what early Christians believed. And as usual, these scholars, for all their factual accuracies, are simply missing the point. The transformation of the evil one from a shadowy and ambiguous character in early Christian and even Jewish imagination to the tragic romantic figure he has become is one of the narrative threads we could follow to trace the development of Western society all the way into our present state of crisis. This narrative development does not end in Milton, but actually continues to grow in post-Milton representations, such as the one we see in Neil Gaiman's The Season of Mist graphic novel. This characterization has actually become the basis for the Lucifer Netflix show. So historically, this transformation actually follows the return to pagan references, and this return has been a tool of revolution from the beginning. It becomes an image of secularism, which informs much of the Renaissance and Enlightenment, and accelerates into the modern age. In fact, the culminating figure of Satan in popular imagination, this figure that attracted Mick Jagger's sympathy, has its precedent in Aeschylus's Prometheus Bound. This ancient Greek tragedy, the Titan punished for bringing humans knowledge, is presented as a noble resistance to the tyrannical father. And seeing all this, one will come to realize that there's absolutely nothing arbitrary about the golden Prometheus statue in Rockefeller Plaza. All of this follows a narrative thread, which is the very story of modernity. So the reason why the Satanic Temple wanted to put up this stupid image of Baphomet in the United States is, believe it or not, the culmination of the same process which made Napoleon Bonaparte fill his Arc de Triomphe with Roman gods. And I wonder if Napoleon could perceive that this gesture of declaring himself emperor while putting a crown on his own head would culminate in the solipsistic video by a pole dancing rapper who seduces the devil to then only kill him and put the crown on himself. One of the historical moments where we can trace the origin of modern occultism and Satanism is when the Knights Templar were disbanded in the 14th century. The legitimacy of the accusations made against them is still being discussed interminably by historians. But in terms of social narrative, it doesn't matter so much if you believe the accusations against the Templars or not. It is quite possible that they did not practice sodomy, they didn't blaspheme against the cross or worship a strange god named Baphomet. In the same vein, in terms of what we're seeing today, it doesn't matter if you believe the accusations against witches in the early modern period either, of these descriptions of their Sabbat masses and their fornicating with demons. Of course, one could argue about this in historical terms, and people can do this interminably until they forget the original point of why such an accusation matters. What matters most is how these new possibilities, which appeared at the end of the Middle Ages, became something like a narrative space, where the opposite of Christianity, which was more implicit before, began to explicitly take form in the form of explicit sacrilege and certain types of parody of inversion, and ultimately embracing the opposite of everything that Christians valued. So we mostly need to see these accusations as an opening up and recognizing of certain possibilities. We could call it something like a narrative space, which showed us the edge and the end of Christianity. And this Antichrist was slowly filled as Christianity itself began to falter and to break apart in the modern age. And it was through these very tools and this very imagery, whether consciously or unconsciously, that Christianity would be attacked by its own dissidents. It's by these very means that it would be inverted and subverted, until even these new pseudo-religions like Satanism and Wicca would explicitly take on, identify, and expand the very tropes which were manifested in those early modern fears. And so even if the accusations against the Templars were fabricated, we arrive nonetheless through a strange process of development through the Enlightenment to the 19th century, to the occultists there like Eliphas Levi and Aleister Crowley, through Bulgakov and, you know, the band Slayer, we come to a point where we have this massively popular and honestly not at all edgy video, which won attention for its sacrilege and allusion to being sodomized by a devil. Ultimately, the figure of this devil is itself a culmination of this late medieval Baphomet who haunted the Templars in the 14th century. You see, stories have patterns. Stories play themselves out naturally, and once the narrative elements have been cast, there will always be people, events, and organizations to embody them in a very factual and incarnate way. But the material causes by which this will happen are actually quite secondary to the more spiritual reasons. You see, when Christ said, "Judge not, lest you be judged," this was not just this finger-wagging moralizing. He was telling people how reality works, how the projecting of our sins onto our enemies, this focused attention on the sin of others, opens up the space of our own end. It gives us a glimpse of what is possible in the story. It gives us a riddle of our own Sphinx, and it is by this very Sphinx that we run the danger of being devoured. Besides the strange movement from Baphomet to Montero, a good example to help people understand what I'm trying to describe and what is happening is that, according to the Malleus Maleficarum, this book about witchcraft that I mentioned earlier and that was published in the early modern period, according to this book, the purpose of witches was to prevent normal reproductive relationships between men and women, and doing this out of resentment. And they accomplished this by several ways, by, for example, seducing men away from their wives, by using disincarnate female demonic phantasm, or succubi, so that men would lose their seed, by making it so women have children from incubi, these demonic males, but actually also through the material causes of having children by other men besides their husbands, and also by killing and harming children, aborting babies, and ultimately, yes, by removing the male member altogether. So 200 years ago, I might have been mocked, maybe not even that long ago, by the well-to-do for suggesting that a group of people would want such a thing for the world. And to be honest, I can understand why the Catholic Inquisition actually rejected the contents of this book and also rejected those that wrote it and were the proponents of its content. But if we see rather these dark descriptions as something like a narrative arc, which is moving towards the end or the dissolution of Christianity, we only have to ponder a moment to realize that whether it is pornography, artificial insemination, whether it's the proliferation and acceptance of abortion, or even young boys that have been put on hormone blockers, I can find prominent contemporary examples of all the ancient witchcraft I just mentioned. So that the early modern witches might have been projections or collective dreams, it's possible, and people will argue either way, is actually not that important to us, and we shouldn't waste our energy on that. What matters now is that these witches are healthy, unabashed, and they're winning the culture war today. So in the show WandaVision, which, by the way, I will definitely spoil for you now, so be warned, the Scarlet Witch, a Marvel hero with magic powers, creates a Matrix-style simulation in a small town, a safe place, in order to preserve and simulate the artificial existence of her robot husband, Vision. Vision, an AI with a robot body, is the perfect man, the wisest, the most moral, the most well-intentioned man you could ever imagine. Such a perfect AI character, a living soul, which is actually worth torturing to preserve, that this is presented to us so straightforwardly at this moment in history and with everything that's happening with social media and around us should already send icy shivers down all our spines. This simulated world that Wanda has created goes so far as to generate simulated children. Her virtual reality takes on the form of sitcoms across the decades, but for the inhabitants of the town, this manifests itself as mind control. The entire town is controlled and tortured by Wanda into doing her will and playing the characters in her sitcom. But when they're off screen, the other people in town actually almost cease to exist. Occasionally in the story, the spell that Wanda has on them breaks loose for a moment and we see these tortured souls peek out.
You have to stop her.
Stop who?
She's in my head. None of it is my own.
We see them pleading to be let go, pleading for the incessant pain to stop, pleading at least for their children to be set free, as the young ones are being controlled by Wanda as well. And all of this for a simulated media reality. Now, such a chilling premise can be imagined in a story where the resentful supervillain, the totalitarian AI, or the 1984-style government is imposing a false reality and controlling people's every action and thought. So what is presented in WandaVision is a version of the Matrix, but strangely enough, from the point of view of the Matrix itself. The torturer, the controller, the dictator is the main character. And although what Wanda's doing is presented to us as being immoral, we're nonetheless called to have far more compassion for her and her suffering for having lost this artificial husband, more compassion for her imaginary children than we are supposed to feel for the children and townspeople she's torturing. All of the supporting characters are trying to save Wanda. And when the zealous leader of the government team that's there to deal with the situation tries to kill her to stop this, he's the one who's presented as the villain. So yes, the fact that the witch is using media to control the narrative, to torture us all by imprisoning us and preventing us from communing with each other, that's a bad thing. But one must understand that the witch has her reasons. And her reasons, what are they? They're to preserve, foster this unholy union with technology and artificial intelligence.
They'll never know what you sacrificed for them.
It wouldn't change how they see me.
Seriously, folks, this is the actual premise of the show. There's an insane moment where a mother pleads with Wanda to at least let her child come out of her room so that she can take it in her arms.
Really anything, if you could just let her out of her room, if I could just hold her, please.
I mean, I swear I could almost see the mother in a medical mask when I heard this. When I was watching this, at some point, I started to ask myself if this strange premise was not secretly some very strange and ingenious argument for witch burning. I'm sure the Malleus Maleficorum, there's definitely a section about witches forcing all reality to follow their whim in order to avoid real masculine-feminine union, real relationships, and ultimately to preserve artificial men and solipsistic fantasy children. I'm sure it's there somewhere. I need to go back there and check. But joking aside, one can easily see how this is all related to Lil Nas X's Montero and his satanic shoes through a strange mixture of victimhood and pride coming together. Just as Montero populates his own world with himself, obsessed with his self-named lover, so too Wanda has bent all minds to her own whims and made them expressions of herself.
We feel your pain. Your grief is poisoning us.
No, stop.
Please, let us go.
So this is truly the place where Western individualism shows its satanic colors. If in American movies we're used to that scene at the end, everybody has seen these, where all the characters in a crowd, you know, all the other characters in the movie, usually with a huge crowd, will applaud the protagonist. And the protagonist is a stand-in for the individual, but mostly for the underdog. But here, in this version, we see the individual with its idiosyncrasies, with all her, his, their fluid desires and whims, imposing themselves as something to which all of society must bend and transform. In Montero's Hell, we see this engraving in flaming letters. We see the famous Latin phrase, ab non quod non intelligent, which means they condemn that they do not understand. And what is wanted through these narrative tropes is ultimately the opposite of that. Something like the misunderstood will condemn them. Something like the exception will invalidate the rule. So if in the Christian vision, the shepherd is willing to leave the flock, to even leave it unprotected, to go out and find one lost sheep, here we rather have this lost sheep demanding that the shepherd not bring the sheep back to the flock, but rather bring the entire flock out into the wilderness. So if in traditional societies, we see this scapegoat mechanism of sacrificing the exception in order to preserve coherence, here it is the opposite of that. It is a desire to sacrifice the entire world for the exception. On a social level, this is what appears as upside-down hierarchies, where the strange, the impure, the exceptional, the fluid, the rejected, the sick, and the unknown become not those we need to help, but they become a new measure by which all of society is evaluated. And so it's only in that sense that the backtracking fears of my 80s youth pastor regarding rock music, just like upside-down crosses and upside-down pentagram, can make sense as a basic narrative intuition. The intuition that the satanic, like a massive carnival on the edge and the end of the Christian world, is acting like an evil Christian jester who wants to be king, who's turning mocking, embodying the upside down of Christianity both morally and ritually. What makes him different from a regular carnival is that this jester is also trying to put the crown on his own head. Because of a consideration for the victim, many of our contemporary social manifestations can dupe Christians into thinking that what is happening is aligned with their values. But stories like WandaVision can help us realize how the very opposite is the case. Whether it be the willingness to destroy our social fabric for the sick, whether it be the advent of woke victimhood culture and its desire to make inclusion the purpose for any group, any sports team, any church or corporation, what we're witnessing is the reverse of Christianity. In his book, Live Not by Lies, Rodrer points us to René Girard's piercing of this upside-down scapegoat mechanism as being the driving force of our entire post-Christian society. In citing Girard, Dreher reminds us how, quote, the current process of spiritual demagoguery and rhetorical overkill has transformed the concern for victims into a totalitarian command and a permanent inquisition. We are living through a caricatural ultra-Christianity that tries to escape from the Judeo-Christian orbit by radicalizing the concern for victims in an anti-Christian manner, unquote. It's important to be aware of what is happening so as to not be duped by Antichrist, as Christ warned us. But underneath all the scandal, all the sacrilege and reversals, there's actually a secret story happening through all of this, and I've hinted at it in my video already. Watching someone like Lil Nas X mock, deride, and invert our stories to the cheers of the media and the cultural gatekeepers, we must remember that Christ chose Judas, who would betray him from within his inner circle. In the same manner, our current situation is part of the story. And the satanic imagery, for all its arrogance and pride, exposes in plain view the underbelly of modern secularism. And though this imagery appears as a manifestation of where Christians have failed, it is nonetheless a restating of the Christian story through attention to its opposite. An upside-down world, a solipsistic, sterile, and artificial world must inevitably flip back. The glorification, even in spiteful jest, of satanic tropes of rebellion reminds us that it is only the crucified one and the story of self-sacrifice which breaks those unending revolutions. Those unending revolutions. Those unending revolutions. Those unending revolutions.
Those unending revolutions. Those unending revolutions.
Hope you like the video. If this video helps you, please subscribe and like the video to mean a lot to me. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Take care.